Hands and Little White Lies presents Close-Ups, Wes Anderson by Sophie Monks Kaufman and Little White Lies, read by Sarah Ovens. Introduction. Family as the hand that feeds and bleeds you. Jack, Jason Schwartzman, aims a can of mace at his brother Francis, Owen Wilson, in the 2007 film The Darjeeling Limited. In the process, he distills a number of recurring truths in the work of the Houston, Texas-born writer-director, Wes Anderson. Families are hotbeds of hurt. Family members lie, disappoint and reject one another, often at the most devastating of times. And parents often fail to look after or even stay alive for their children. The pain of coming from a dysfunctional home is writ large across every Anderson picture. And yet, for all the drama this pain causes, the subsequent hurt is rarely terminal. With reddened eyes and harbouring a lightly comic sense of stifled justice, the family unit limps on. Children in adults' clothing. Unlike in happily ever after children's yarns, Wes Anderson's characters don't get what they initially think they want. Or else they do, but only briefly, before time dispatches them onwards. This sounds bleak, and would be if presented in a stark manner. However, Wes's films are the opposite of stark. He builds spectacles infused with childlike wonder, and in doing so, sweetens the pill of certain death. If there is a message to be taken from all these images, it is, don't be a jaded grown-up while there's still time on the clock. Wes almost sabotages himself by employing a childlike delivery of adult wisdom. Instead of having all the elements of cinema at the service of a single view, he has profound emotions dressed up in ornate doll's clothing in what is almost a tonal conflict. The recurring fact of someone coming unglued. I guess when I think about it, one of the things I like to dramatize, and what is sometimes funny, is someone coming unglued, said Anderson in a 2012 interview. We watch as his characters come unglued from life's big external mechanisms, work, the law, the scouting movement. They come unglued from personal attachments, family connections and romantic relationships. And finally, this glue chips away from abstract things, sanity, health and existence itself. Showing people becoming unglued is a way to show who they really are. Blending in with society, i.e. not becoming unglued, dooms a person to anonymity. W.H. Auden's 1940 poem, The Unknown Citizen, is a satirical tribute to a man whose only graces were his utter lack of identifying features. As Auden wrote, "Our researchers into public opinion are content that he held the proper opinions for the time of year. When there was peace, he was for peace. When there was war, he went." After illustrating a lifetime of flying beneath the radar, Auden ends the poem with these lines. Was he free? Was he happy? The question is absurd. Had anything been wrong, we should certainly have heard. Anderson's unglued characters tend not to be unknown citizens. His dialogue is almost entirely comprised of things real people never say, but probably think. It's like hearing the gaps between the pauses in polite conversation, wrote Susie McKenzie. I am very sorry for your loss, says Gene Hackman's huckster patriarch in 2001's The Royal Tenenbaums to his two recently bereaved grandsons. Your mother was a terribly attractive woman. However these people may suffer, it is rarely in repressed silence. Indeed, idiosyncratic characters drive the narratives. To backtrack for a moment. Wes Anderson has, to date, written and directed 9 feature films. He has made a handful of short features, some advertisements, and has acted as producer on 3 films. His friend Noah Baumbach's The Squid and the Whale, 2005. His idol Peter Bogdanovich's She's Funny That Way, 2014. And Curiosity documentary project Escapes, 2017. Still, Wes, which is how I shall henceforth be referring to him, is primarily known for his own film work. A Wes Anderson feature presentation times 9, and some shorts. The year was 1996, and the movie was called Bottle Rocket, which is where our story begins. It was adapted from a Sundance screened short made with the actors Owen Wilson, Luke Wilson, and Robert Musgrave. Whatever happened to him? Wes roped in cinematographer Robert Yeoman, who he admired for his work on Gus Van Sant's Drugstore Cowboy, by writing him a charming letter. Aside, Robert is not sure how Wes got his home address. It was the beginning of a long-term alliance. Good and helpful people were now on his side. L.M. Kit Carson, director of the seminal doc fiction hybrid film David Holzman's Diary from 1967, joined as producer. The Indian character actor and vaudevillian Kumar Palana was enlisted for a small role. Andrew Wilson, brother of Luke and Owen, signed up to play jock bully Future Man. The result was a story of friendship, petty crime, and first love delivered in Wes's signature deadpan tone, but not his signature look. It is the least symmetrical and stylized of all his works. It offers a showcase for the Wilsons, screen debuts for all three. The film didn't do major business at the box office, which was chalked up to a marketing snafu. But that didn't stop Wes, who rolled out another movie within 2 years. Enter Jason Schwartzman, in his first screen role, looking different to how the now iconic character of go-getting private schoolboy Max Fisher was initially envisaged. A Mick Jagger type. Rushmore, 1998, is the story of a precocious kid who pursues too many things and eventually learns to be satisfied with less. Enter Bill Murray, an established movie star with a run of largely comedic, big-hitting roles under his belt. Caddyshack, Stripes, Tootsie, Groundhog Day, to name but a few. He accepted to work for a pittance and, indeed, donated $35,000 of his own money to achieve a vital helicopter shot. Seymour Cassell, a character actor known for his collaborations with American indie godhead John Cassavetes, joined as Max's father, playing a rare example within Anderson's oeuvre of a tranquil male homebody. Enter what would be a recurring motif of the unattainable love interest slash peak of a love triangle in teacher Miss Cross, played by Olivia Williams. Enter elaborate framing devices and a montage introduction to all of Max's extracurricular clubs. Enter a uniform that is among those synonymous with Wes's visual iconography, the blazer, tie, and glasses. Next, the scale of production was upped and Wes's birth state of Texas left behind for the New York of the Royal Tenenbaums 2002. This was the director's first bash at working with an expansive ensemble cast, which included Angelica Houston, who would become his joint most recurring female player alongside Tilda Swinton. It also featured a number of single-serving stars, including Gwyneth Paltrow, Danny Glover, Ben Stiller, and Gene Hackman. The latter was a disgruntled collaborator who on set yelled accusingly at Wes, "You promised me I'd be happy." The film is a character-driven story about a dysfunctional family and the many failures of love. It remains his most overt homage to literary hero J.D. Salinger and his first time wading in thematically dark waters. Someone dies and there is a suicide attempt. The film is author crazy and book crazy. It is the first of three films which use a book as a framing device for the story. From New York, he sailed off to Cinecittà Studios in Rome to make The Life Aquatic with Steve Zissou, 2004. The first instance of what would become a personal trend of choosing locations that enabled him to travel abroad. Inspired by the classic marine life documentaries by French oceanographer Jacques-Yves Cousteau, this was Wes's most overtly autobiographical work in that the character of Zissou, played by Bill Murray, as well as being an explorer, is also a filmmaker and the head of a ragtag crew. Underlying the adventure story is another dysfunctional family narrative, as Steve struggles to be a father to his long-lost son, Ned, Owen Wilson, and Team Zissou must band together to track down the jaguar shark who killed their beloved colleague Esteban. Loyal collaborator Murray excels in his most centrally billed role, and the character has since become a poster child for depression. Enter soon-to-be regulars Jeff Goldblum, Willem Dafoe, and Waris Ahluwalia. The red beanies, silvery blue wetsuits, custom Adidas trainers, and the Belafonte, a boat whose interior was built from scratch, make this the trademark aesthetic which even casual Wes fans recognise. In some ways, it is an albatross. By this point, Wes's signature style was significantly established to be ripe for parody. American Express, My Life, My Card, from 2006, was, unlike most TV adverts, inspired by François Truffaut's 1973 send-up of movie-making, Day for Night, even using the same Georges Delerue soundtrack. Dressed in a tan suit, Wes himself is introduced with a caption as Wes Anderson, director, in trademark yellow Futura font, yelling, "Cut, cut, not enough smoke, and the snow was too loud," before striding across a movie set, giving precise, eccentric orders in a businesslike tone. It works as a funny example of the director retooling his style for a mass-market product while retaining a sense of individual credibility, and it is the first example of many forays into the world of luxuriant commercial making. From the heights of absurdity to earthbound railway tracks for the Darjeeling Limited 2007, Wes's most earnest depiction of death and grief. Centred on three brothers who meet a year after their father's death to travel around India, ostensibly to visit their AWOL mother, but more urgently to renew their ties. Filmed on location in India, Wes's signature, heightened style was criticised by some as insultingly removed from native reality. The film was set aboard a moving train and was created by method writing. Wes, Jason Schwartzman and Roman Coppola wrote the film while travelling around the locations visited by their fictional counterparts. Hotel Chevalier arrived alongside the main feature as an optional chapter one and sees Schwartzman's character liaising with a young woman, Natalie Portman, in a hotel in Paris. This doleful short features splotches of rich yellow and is set to Peter Sarsted's 1969 ballad, Where Do You Go To, My Lovely, which is played on repeat. After melding sincerely with more adult themes, Wes in 2009 then burrowed underground into a foxhole of childlike imagination, adapting Roald Dahl's 1973 novel Fantastic Mr. Fox into his first stop-motion puppet feature film. Production was based in the UK, in outdoor locations, and at the animation studio 3 Mills in Bow, East London. Wes went on visual inspiration gathering reconnaissance missions to Dahl's former residence, Gypsy House, in Buckinghamshire. This is where he began to dot his family cast with A-listers, George Clooney and Meryl Streep playing Mr. and Mrs. Fox, respectively. And it also signalled his increasing power within the film industry. The story is Wes's most simple. A family animal battles existentially with his wild nature and literally with his trigger-happy neighbourhood farmers, Bogus, Bunce and Bean. Much admiring praise was heaped upon his mania for picturesque detail as applied within an entirely hand-built world. He returned to the USA for Moonrise Kingdom 2012 to turn Rhode Island into a 60s time capsule. Not that any of his movies are bound by modern rigours, but this was his first overt period piece. It is the tale of two 12-year-olds who fall in love and run away together. He's Sam, Jared Gilman, an orphaned Cub Scout who wears chunky glasses. She's Susie, Cara Hayward, a troubled child with a love of pop music and kittens. Sad adults pepper the backdrop, such as Susie's parents, Bill Murray and Frances McDormand, and a melancholic police captain, Bruce Willis. The film was inspired by Waris Hussein's 1971 film Melody, about two primary school kids who escape from their school in Lambeth, London, in order to marry. Alongside this came a trio of little ones. Cousin Ben Troop screening with Jason Schwartzman, 2012, is a two-minute Meta Moonrise promo created for the humour website, Funny or Die. Schwartzman's small but tasty character, the authoritative and highly bribable Scoutmaster Ben, takes centre stage to preside over a scout screening of Moonrise Kingdom. The humour derives from his ball-busting approach to marshalling his young and uncowed charges. Then came the apex of Wes's obsession with female romantics who, by virtue of their innocent feminine charms, create love triangles as men fall at their feet. The Prada advert Candy, 2013, is perhaps his silliest work and is notable for marking his first collaboration with the French actress Lea Seydoux, who would fill out a small role as a maid in the Grand Budapest Hotel. Then another Prada short, this time with more narrative, Castello Cavalcanti, 2013, is named after a fictional mid-century racing driver played by Schwartzman, and the story sees him crashing in a town revealed to have been home to his ancestors. Over spaghetti and deadpan conversation, a poignant connection is established. It's a film of bright colours and pregnant pauses. Capers, The Grand Budapest Hotel, 2015, is the story of a concierge and his lobby boy who becomes mixed up with a murderous relative.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.